existence are alive and well right here. We're finally going to turn to Laura Flanders. Many of us are familiar with Laura's work via The Nation, Yes Magazine, and MSNBC. She has her own TV show, Grit TV, and she has several books, Blue Grit, True Democrats Take Back Politics, and Bushwomen, Tales of a Cynical Species. Please welcome Laura Flanders.
Crisis?
No.
No, we can handle that, right? But it is a little cold right here, right now. So if you need to go like this, just, you know, check in that you're still really here. And let's think about some other real crises. Our economy dependent on poverty, bigotry, and war that Chris Hedges described. Is that a crisis?
Yes.
The thousands of children that are out there right now, homeless and hungry in this one of the richest cities in the world, is this a crisis?
Yes.
Our media in Midtown just blocks away yawning at this reality and at this event. Is that a crisis?
Yes.
We'll handle it. I have the great fortune, thanks to the model of crowdsourcing that is called independent media, to be able to talk to people every day who bring me their voices, their visions, their plans, and their actions to change today's world into a better place. I hear from them a lot, and it often takes just quieting down a little, listening carefully. And when I listen, well, try it here. We're talking about voices of hope in a time of crisis. We've established the crisis part. Now let's hear if we can, let's listen to see if we can hear any voices. If you close your eyes and ears, and sometimes they go together, and try to listen. Close your eyes, maybe. Think of a vision. Your vision of hope. Did anybody see a better gun? A bigger bank? I bet even a bigger Senate majority didn't lead to jump to mind. What I do hear, and what I do see when I take a moment to listen, or travel around the country, thanks to the benevolent support of Grit TV's supporters, as I hear people like the people of Jackson, Mississippi, who are digging deep into the history of cooperative economics in the black community, to see a new vision of how they could, through self-sustaining cooperation within a regional network, revive the economy of the slavery-ravaged South. I hear the voices that I've had the chance of talking to, the people I've had a chance to talk to for Yes Magazine in Appalachia, who are digging deep into their history and remembering that their region, now one of the poorest and most victim to global corporations in our world, how their region is also home to one of the most diverse and environmentally rich and valuable forest lands on this continent, how their region used to be the number one apple producer in this entire country. They exported chestnuts from the mountaintops of Appalachia to the streets of Manhattan. They exported ginseng from those forests to China. They're digging into that history, not just for a vision of hope, but a memory of how an economy used to exist, what other economies used to exist right here. We don't have to make this up from scratch. And then I hear from people right here in New York City working together in a cooperative alliance, managed to secure for the first time, not just a progressive majority, with all due respect to the Working Families Party, and I do mean due respect to the Working Families and the progressive majority, I mean it, with due respect to that organizing, we won a progressive majority on the city council in this city a few years ago. We have elected an array of progressive candidates, and we have gotten from those candidates, once they've been brought into office in our city, some true progress. Meaning, for example, among other things, the first ever more than $1 million dedicated to incubating and supporting cooperative economic initiatives right here in New York. work. We get people elected, and we do manage to get something back from them. The work has to continue. I hear stories like that, people figuring out how, even in our screwed up system that Chris Hedges described, we can not just work together, but advance an agenda that could possibly make a difference in the lives of those people that I mentioned at the very beginning. But let's be serious. Hope needs help. When we talk about hope, it's the temptation is to project outside of ourselves. Someone else will do it. Some other time it will happen. If I sit here quietly, maybe I won't bother anyone enough that they'll leave me alone. That's not what I hear. What I hear from the people of Mississippi is they're not going to be able to accomplish their vision of change without reparations. What I hear from the people of Appalachia is they're not going to be able to revive their apple orchards without true land reform. What I hear from the people right here is we're not really going to be getting not the 1 million, but the multi-millions we need to go from the subsidized multinational corporations of Wall Street and the media corporations to whom we continue to give endless tax breaks. We're not going to be able to transfer our wealth and our treasure and our values from there to an alternative vision of cooperative economics if we don't have a true democracy, if we don't have true popular representation. So when I think about voices of hope, I think about action. And I can almost never be in this hall without thinking of one person, Clara Lemlich. Clara Lemlich was 16 years old in 1909. And she was a Lithuanian shirtwaist seamstress working in one of the crowded, overcrowded, dangerous fire truck factories of Lower Manhattan. And in 1909, she came to yet another union meeting right here in this hall, and some blowhard old guy was up here leading the union into yet one more boring election where they would discuss yet one more boring possibility of possible action, maybe sometime. And Clara Lemlich had had enough. She knew the fire conditions in her factory. She knew the life her co-workers were leading. She may have been 16 and she didn't know English that well, but she stood at the back of that hall and she shouted, "Strike." She got the attention of the hall. Following her call for industrial action, 30,000 workers in New York City went on strike, the largest strike of its time, led by women workers, many of them not much older than Clara. Clara Lemlich led the march and the strike that inspired International Working Women's Day, March 8th. If she'd been listened to, if that strike had actually got its demands met, the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire of 1911, which took place just a few blocks west of here, might never have happened. Those 110 lives might have been saved, those bodies might have never hit the sidewalk. I'm excited to be here because I see our focus on the local possibility. I see our connection to the global. People in Appalachia can't do it without us. The people in Mississippi can't do it without us. We need to connect regionally, globally. We need to hope. We need to have vision. We need to listen. And we need to act. Thanks.
So now is the point where you act, and what I'd like to invite you each to do is turn to your neighbor for about 2 minutes and just share what's on your mind. What are the things that you really want to talk about here? This is an opportunity to sort of shape your ideas, and then we'll open it up for folks to, you know, ask questions or give short comments. So take just 2 minutes and see what's on your mind.